The brain is a bit of a mystery. While we've managed to put together where certain processes take place within the brain, it's hard to say whether or not we will ever fully understand it. In fact, some experts argue we won't ever be able to fully describe how the brain works. At the same time, science has allowed us to understand this essential organ to some extent. We know where certain information is processed. We know generally how things are connected within the brain and nervous system. We know what the brain is made of. Surprisingly, your brain is about 75% water. And we know broadly how the brain processes sensory information. For instance, did you know that multitasking is actually impossible? Or that the brain is able to filter for relevant sensory information and integrate it if it's necessary for the task at hand? It's pretty incredible. In this video, we're going to examine 7 incredible brain mechanisms for processing sensory information. How does the brain recognize what the eye see? How does a seasoned tennis player process information better and faster than a newbie? We're going to answer all of this, but first, click the like button, ring that bell, and subscribe to our channel, Brain Health Smarts. And stick around to the end. We're going to be giving away a free gift, and you won't want to miss it. Now, let's dive in. 7. Sight. How can your brain tell what you're looking at and actually attach meaning to it? For example, when you're reading a book, what's going on inside those intricate neural networks within the brain? When it comes down to it, visual perception starts with your eyes. When light hits the retina of the eye, photoreceptors, a special type of cell, convert these light signals into electric signals. The optic nerve carries these signals to your brain. The visual cortex, located in the occipital lobe in the back of the brain, then creates a visual image of what you're looking at. And this all happens very quickly. In fact, the eyes and human brain process images in as little as 13 milliseconds. That's fast. When reading, your brain actually mixes these visual processes with language comprehension and speech production. And we aren't born readers. We have to learn it. And to learn to read, we have to use parts of the brain that evolved for other purposes. The temporal parietal cortex in the brain allows us to understand speech sound and word meaning. In this area of the brain, we sound out words, specifically when that word is unfamiliar. The inferior frontal cortex further helps us pronounce these sounds and words. Then the occipital temporal cortex helps us learn to recognize words by sight, which is how, as adults, we can easily read through a whole book in a matter of hours. And these processes are the same, no matter what language you're reading. But wait, what about speed reading? Are speed readers actually better than average readers? Is this information processed differently? Interestingly, a study by researchers at the University of California, the University of Victoria, and Washington University discovered speed readers trade accuracy for time. In fact, slow reading, even where you go back and reread a previous sentence or paragraph, is associated with deeper and better learning. Fast reading just doesn't give the brain enough to process and retain the information entirely. But there are ways around this. For instance, visual reading associates the meaning of words with images. This can actually help a person read faster and possibly retain it. Yet it's clear from a quick Google search that more research needs to be done in this area. So let's move on to physical touch. 6. Touch. How does the brain process physical touch? How does it detect when you're lifting something heavy? The skin is home to countless touch receptors. In fact, one fingertip has about 3,000 touch receptors. And these touch receptors can further be broken down into different mechanoreceptor types, including the Meissner's corpuscles, which detect pressure and lower frequency vibrations, the Pacinian corpuscles, which respond to transient pressure and higher frequency vibrations, Merkel's discs, which respond to light pressure, and Ruffini corpuscles, which detect stretch. On top of these touch receptors, there are thermoreceptors that react to hot or cold temperatures, chemoreceptors, which respond to chemicals applied to the skin, and nociceptors, which fire when there is a tissue-damaging stimuli. All of these receptors work together to signal to your brain what you are touching at any particular moment and whether or not it's safe. For example, say you touch something warm, not too hot that it causes pain, but maybe a pan that had been in the oven 30 to 45 minutes ago. Your touch receptors, particularly your thermoreceptors, fire off. These signals travel up the sensory nerves to your spinal cord. From there, they are received by the thalamus portion of the brain, which then relays this information to the cerebral cortex. This information is then processed within the sensory cortex, and this is where you recognize that the object you are touching is warm. In terms of lifting something heavy, your mechanoreceptors, particularly those responsible for pressure, detect the heaviness via how much pressure is placed on your hands or arms. These signals, again, travel to the brain where you decide whether or not it's actually safe to lift the object or not. Fascinating, isn't it? And there's more. Next up is how your brain processes movement. 5. Movement. How does a seasoned athlete perform and process information better than a new player? What's going on in your nervous system and brain when you move your body? The more you practice something, the stronger your neural pathways become. Your body and brain definitely use the "if you don't use it, you lose it" strategy, which can explain why after many years of not playing soccer or football, you might be a bit rusty. In fact, a lot of stroke research and rehab revolves around the idea of finding new neural pathways to perform movements that were once done through pathways that are now destroyed. This is why stroke and other brain injury rehab and recovery can be so intense. There has to be a ton of practice to make it work. Basically, the brain controls movement within the frontal lobe. The premotor areas plan and coordinate a variety of complex movements, and they do this pretty quickly, especially when those pathways are strengthened through practice. In the brain, the process ends with the primary motor cortex, which sends the information down the spinal cord and to the muscles, and this is where your muscles contract and your body moves. And again, the only way to improve and strengthen these neural connections is practice. The brain and nervous system love repetition, and this truly is the secret to becoming great at something. Now, our next sensory mechanism is smell, but before we get there, let's get you your free gift. Our free book, Brain Food Secrets, the 15 worst and best foods for your brain, gives way to the best foods to improve brain function, improve your mood, and enhance mental clarity. Grab your copy by clicking the link in the description below. Now back to our list. 4. Smell. When walking into the kitchen, you can immediately tell whether or not cookies are baking in the oven. You can also immediately sense when a bad smell is afoot. So how does this process work in the brain? How does your brain know the difference between a bad versus good smell or a strong versus mild odor? As you inhale air through your nose, the odor molecules bind to receptors. These receptors then relay this information to your brain. And surprisingly, one smell can have a variety of different odor molecules involved. Some research suggests the smell of chocolate, for instance, has hundreds of odor molecules. From the receptors in your nose, the information travels to the olfactory cortex in the brain. Scientists have even created spatial maps of this area of the brain, indicating where it detects good, bad, strong, and mild odors. On top of this, experts theorize that this part of the brain might have direct access to areas of the brain involved in memory and emotion. This is why certain memories can be triggered by certain smells. So next time you take a whiff of that delicious smelling candle, thank your olfactory cortex. It's got a lot going on. Now let's dive into 3. Taste. Sampling foods, wine, and more are one of the most simple pleasures of life. Who doesn't love a good food or wine tour? And this whole sensory experience begins with your taste buds. But that's not the only reason certain foods and beverages taste a certain way. Smell sensory processes also come into play here. Basically, your nose and mouth connect through the same airway. This means when you bite into a moist and delicious piece of chocolate cake, you're also smelling it. So while your taste buds detect whether something is sweet, salty, bitter, sour, or savory, smell and taste combined give way to individual flavors. This taste information is all processed within the primary gustatory cortex. Smell from the olfactory cortex and taste combine in the brain, which give way to the flavors you experience in the food you eat. So next time you're entrenched in a culinary experience, you'll know a little bit more about what's going on beneath the surface. And maybe you'll appreciate it even more. Now let's examine and explore the processes involved in sound. 2. Hearing. How does your brain allow you to enjoy musical compositions? What happens for you to understand and communicate with others? As you can probably guess, this process starts with auditory stimuli entering the ear canal. This causes the eardrum to move, which is why eardrum damage can be so detrimental to a person's ability to hear. Now, the eardrum actually vibrates differently depending on different sounds. From there, these vibrations travel through the ossicles to the cochlea, where it then moves the fluid located in this area. This then causes the hair cells located in this area to move. The auditory nerve then takes these signals and relays them to the brain. The auditory cortex in the temporal lobe processes this information, providing you with sound or helping you understand what another person is saying to you. If you can hear something but can't understand it, this indicates problems with the auditory processing system in the brain. Interestingly, when you hear a particularly pleasing sound, your brain immediately releases dopamine, which is why music can give you those feel-good feelings. And now last but not least, let's talk about 1, balance. Balance involves proprioception, which is your body's ability to be aware of where your body is in space. Every muscle movement you have involves proprioception. Surprisingly, this all starts within the vestibular system, also known as the inner ear system. This system works with the visual systems in your brain to ensure you maintain balance and perform movements correctly and accurately. The structures and fluid of the inner ear sense and respond to movement and gravitational changes. These signals are sent to the brain where they are processed with visual information in the cerebellum. That way you stay upright, you're able to coordinate movements, and you don't experience vertigo, which is something that can happen when your inner ear structures become damaged. So there you have it, the 7 incredible brain mechanisms involved in processing sensory information. What did you think? Did we miss anything? Let us know in the comments below. And before you leave, don't forget to like this video, ring that bell, and subscribe to our channel. Make sure you also grab that free book by clicking the link in the description below. In the book, Brain Food Secrets, the 15 Worst and Best Foods for Your Brain, you'll uncover a variety of brain-boosting foods, helping you achieve even greater cognition and mental clarity. Thanks for watching. We hope you have a healthy and happy day.